Good morning, church. How's everybody doing today? It is so awesome to have everybody here with us today. Why don't we all stand together and join in worshiping our God?
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Welcome, everyone. You may take a seat.
Good morning, church. We're so glad you're with us this morning. My name is Katie, and today I'm hosting with...
Hello, my name is Jackson Lane, and I'm very happy that all of you guys could be here today.
So also, good morning to the online people. We can't wait to see you guys in person.
If you are new here, go to myclc.info/new here.
So on Sunday, May 1st, we are going to be celebrating new life. So We're going to be doing baptisms and child dedications. So if you want more information on that, go to myclc.info/next-steps. Also today, this is more directed to the online people. We are doing communion today, so if you would like to participate, you can find something around your house that you can do communion with us.
There are many ways to receive the information for the week, as well as websites, newsletters, text, social media, and next step tables.
During this next song, we have a chance to do some giving with our church. We have our baskets up at the altar, and of course, our website.
myclc.info/sharing. Now please stand and worship our great God.
We're heaven's spun creation, His pride and adoration, treasures woven by His love. His careful hands, they hold us safe within His promise of calling and of destiny. We're heaven's spun creation, His pride and adoration, treasures woven by His love. His careful hands, they hold us safe within His promise of calling and of destiny. Worship you.
We worship you, Lord. You are here, and you are good. We worship. We sing to you.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after.
Reading from Psalm 32. Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those who record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. When I refused to confess my sin, my body was wasted away, and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all of my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. Therefore, let all the godly pray to you while there is still time, that they may not drown in the floodwaters of judgment. For you are my hiding place. You protect me from trouble. You surround me with the songs of victory. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. Do not be like a senseless horse or mule that needs a bit and bridle to keep it under control. Many sorrows come to the wicked, but unfailing love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. So rejoice in the Lord and be glad, all you who obey him. Shout for joy, all of the hearts that are pure. Will you please pray with me? Dear Lord, thank you for allowing us to come together as a church this Sunday and worship you. We ask that you guide our hearts through this message today and keep our minds focused. We ask that you watch over those who need you in your life, that you guide them towards you and help them with the troubles they are facing. Please watch over us as we take on this next week. We ask all this in your precious and holy name. Amen. You may now be seated.
If you've ever gone hiking before, especially in the winter, you know that breaking trail is something you do when you encounter deep snow that's tough to navigate. When that happens, one hiker usually goes ahead of their group and clears the way so others can follow behind more easily. A trail breaker is someone who goes ahead, who makes a new way, who invites others to follow along behind them. In so many ways, that's exactly what Jesus did for us. But he did so much more than that too. Jesus never gives up on us. He understands our pain. He shows us love. He is alive. He can be trusted. And he gives us a mission.
Good morning, church family. Good to see your faces. Good to be gathered together in one place. And I'm telling you what, I'm so proud of you for being here today because it snowed. I'm not saying anything about you that are watching online. You're gathering online. That's kind of a cool thing, too. And so just talking to the people here for just a moment. Glad you're there, too. So we want to make sure we're all on the same page as we go into the message here. We are going to take communion. We've got our little communion to-go package, pretty cool things. If you did not receive one and you want one, raise your hand, and we'll make sure that somebody comes and gets you one over here. Can we get some more of those communion cups? Okay. You're all good. It's all good. It's all good. That's what family does. When one person's just doing their thing and another person steps in, it's all good. Good job. Okay. Anybody else that needs them? Everybody's all got it. We got a couple over here as well in the back corner. Super good. So make sure you have that. Do not get into it early. Right, wait for that. And this little booklet you received on your way in, the board of directors nominees, put that down. We're going to talk about that at the end after we're all wrapped up here. All right, today starts a brand new series we're calling Break Trail, an incredible thing for us to learn about what it means to be those who break the trail. And we're going to be jumping into this idea as we learn about Jesus leading up to Easter. You had to admit that I was going to bring Jesus into the mix at some point since we're leading into Easter. And so we're going to go from today all the way through May 1st. There's 6 weeks where we're going to talk about this leader that we know of as Jesus and his roles in everything. I mean, he was everything and is everything. So we're going to be talking about that. And on May 1st, we have New Life Sunday, which is child dedication and baptism. So that's a great opportunity for you to go to the Next Step table, which is the only blue table in the lobby. Go over there, or you can go online, myclc.info. Very simple, and you can sign up, and we'll talk with you and try to walk you through what that looks like. So that's kind of exciting. So today we begin, and our big idea for today is rather simple. The big idea is Jesus never gives up on us. Amen? Aren't you glad that Jesus did not give up on you? I'm telling you what, I'm a guy that there was a point in my life where I'm going, he probably would be better just to move on, just to keep moving on. There's got to be a better one that could do this or could do that. And yet, he never gave up on me. And so as we look through this series called Break Trail, we're talking about a simple concept of somebody making a way for somebody else. In the understanding of snow, which so grateful that we have the illustration out there today, that in our highest, our deepest snow that we experienced this summer, we have some people that would step into the snow and create these huge steps, right? And then somebody would come behind and be like, oh, thanks for putting those steps there. Right here along Curtis Street, as I would walk across the street for no other reason than to go to the restaurant there, and there would be big steps, and I would step where somebody else has set before me. And so this idea here is that these people that create new paths are known as trailblazers. Now, we don't always use that literally, but a trailblazer is someone who has forged a new and different kind of path. Jesus, when he popped on the scene, God in the flesh, the man Christ, the Messiah, the Savior, he began to forge a new and different kind of path. Some trailblazers you may be familiar with also, some people, you know this name, Steve Jobs. Whether you own Apple products or not, it doesn't matter. He has so revolutionized the way that we do technology and the way that we have access to technology. Instead of it just being for the super rich, that any of us can own a form of technology. And Steve Jobs helped pave the way for that. Another story, you may be familiar with the content, but you may not remember the name. The lady's name is Ruby Bridges. Ruby was the first African-American student to attend a formerly all-white school in Louisiana. Even though the Supreme Court ruled that the school should be desegregated in 1954, most schools just ignored this decision. It wasn't until in 1960, that 6 years after the Supreme Court's ruling, that Ruby was escorted to school while angry protesters stood on the sidelines. The decision had already been made, you see. It was already decided that this could happen. But somebody had to break trail in order to make it better for other people to come. So she figuratively began to walk in the snow, creating these steps where other people could come behind her. Ruby Bridges was that amazing trailblazer. And finally, we know the name Henry Ford. The father of the motor vehicle changed the world as we know it. Not only was Ford a technological innovator, he also pioneered the technique of mass production. Just so many changes that somebody said, hey, let's do it different. It will be better, and then pave the way for other people to be able to follow in those steps. Jesus revolutionized everything when he showed up. Through his birth, his life, his teachings, his death, his resurrection, there are so many ways that Jesus broke new ground. He made way for us to be changed forever, an actual way. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus said, an actual way to the Father. There wasn't a direct route to the Father. When you study the idea of Old Testament temples and sacrifices, there wasn't a direct way. It wasn't until Jesus died on the cross and the veil was torn, and that symbolically went away. Now we have direct access in Christ to the Father. Jesus blazed trails. And we can follow that trail to the Father. Jesus gave us a new way to look at something that none of us like, failure. He gave us a new way to look at failure, both ours and others. Maybe you've had a moment when, like me, you've hurt someone you love and wish you could rewind the tape and change it. Oh, I wish I would have not said that. Oh, if only I would have just held my tongue. If only you wish you could go back and change it. Or you've trusted someone else to keep a secret or a promise and they let you down. They bailed on you. They betrayed you. Or maybe, just maybe, you've done something to yourself and you let yourself down. Maybe you're frustrated that you can't measure up to whatever standard you set for yourself. I'm telling you what, we raise a standard It's so interesting. Humans are so weird. Aren't we just weird people? We're so weird. We will raise standards and not even be logical about it. Some people raise their standards so high, nobody could get to it. Not even them. Some people don't even have a standard, so they hit it every time. Other people will raise standards on other people and not even tell them anything about it, or they just put these expectations on them. The standard is for real. Like, we put such heavy expectations on ourselves, and then when we don't reach those expectations, then we say, people were right. You weren't gonna amount to much. And so sometimes you just need to give yourself a break. I tell people that, I say, man, you gotta give yourself a break. Perfection is never the goal. Perfection is never the goal. Relationship is the goal. Perfection is not the goal. And in scripture, when it talks about perfection, oftentimes it talks about maturity. It talks about actual maturity in Christ, not that you get it all right all the time. So as we go into today, we're looking at two individuals. You may very well be familiar with these two individuals. You have the one that we know, Judas Iscariot. We're going to look about how he betrayed and denied with his life, with his decisions, Jesus. And then we're going to look at Peter and how he betrayed and denied Jesus. And then if that's not, say, we're familiar with that. We're familiar with how people mess up. Amen. We're familiar with that. But to see Jesus's response to that, that's going to blaze some trails. So we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 22. Turn on your Bibles or turn on your mobile device. Open your iPad to Luke 22. And we also have it on the screens here if you want to follow along that way. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. So if it's a little bit different from yours, you can make some notes however you choose to. I encourage you to go back and reread these. Often, I would use your whole week and go back and just review and review and review. One, to be a good student of the word, and two, to check up on me. You shouldn't just take it and be like, well, that's what he said. You should review it. Review it and see what it really says there. Luke chapter 22, we're going into the time of Passover. Jesus knows that his death is coming. But his disciples and his friends are like not really sure, even though he tries to explain it. So we're going to go through this little by little and kind of pick this apart. So Luke chapter 22, verse 1 to 6. The festival of unleavened bread, which is also called Passover, was approaching. Now, just for a little clarity here so we understand our word, the word of God, we have two festivals actually going on here. We have the festival of the unleavened bread, and then we have the Passover. And so what we have here is we're celebrating both the time of Passover, where while the Israelites were in Egypt, there was a time where they would slaughter a lamb, and they would, during the plagues, they'd put it over the archway of their home as instructed by God. And then when the Spirit of God, or I believe scripture refers to it as the spirit of death, comes by, then they will pass over your house. And so we celebrate the Passover, which is really celebrating the goodness of God. And then you have the festival of the unleavened bread, which is recognizing the time that the Israelites were able to escape from Egypt. I heard it said the reason why it's unleavened bread is because they had to bust out of Egypt so fast, they had to make some bread really quick, they didn't have time to put the leaven in the bread. So therefore, it doesn't rise later on. And so here they're celebrating this as a reminder of God's goodness. They're celebrating the festival. And these festivals were not a birthday party with a few balloons. This was not something that was like, hey, if you feel like coming over, we'll hang out. To this day, it is a huge celebration of Passover for the Jewish people. They will celebrate that there'll be tens of thousands and thousands of people that will gather in to Jerusalem, and they will worship and they will sing. Now it's incomplete, of course, because they're celebrating, yes, but then they stop there without celebrating the Messiah. We know that the Messiah has come. The Messiah has set us free, created a new path, a new trail for us. And so it's exciting though to see this commitment. this celebration. And in the Bible days, this was enormous. Let's say in the day of the Bibles, there was probably about 100,000 to 150,000 people that lived in that area. And so then even more people would come in and it would be huge, huge crowds of people. Verse 2, the leading priests and the teachers of religious law were plotting how to kill Jesus. Now, they've been frustrated with Jesus for a while because he's saying things and they don't like what he's saying. He's saying true things and they don't like the true things that he's saying. And so as they're sitting there, they're going through plotting how to kill Jesus. Isn't this interesting that religious people, these in our terminology, the church people, they're sitting there not discussing if they should, they're discussing how they should kill Jesus. Now, when we look at that, we'd say, oh man, those guys are nuts. We would never do that. It's interesting, though, that we do actually have the power of life and death in our tongue, that we will use our tongue to kill people. You may not physically take somebody out, but believe it or not, in your conversations, we're still plotting their demise by saying, did you hear that so-and-so did this or so-and-so did that? It's the art of gossip. It's still something we need to be absolutely aware of and stay away from. So they're talking about how to kill Jesus here. But they were afraid of the people's reaction. Now, the reason why they were afraid is because there's so many people and they like Jesus. And if they kill Jesus, then all of a sudden, well, we don't want to upset the people. And so they try to do it in a secret way. Then Satan entered into Judas Iscariot, who is the one of the 12 disciples. This is not the only time that we hear this reference. Satan entered into Judas. Once when he was plotting, and then once when he was actually doing the betrayal. It's so interesting, this, his journey, his routine, if you will. Okay, I'm in, I'm out. I'm in, I'm out. And the way that he just walks so closely with the Lord. Friendship talk, interactions. And yet here we have a moment where he's just greedy. And I never got over that. He never got over that. He's just a greedy guy. He's always been greedy. The time when they said, hey, why would you pour that perfume on Jesus? That could have been sold and we could have sent the money and give it to the poor. He didn't care about the poor. He was greedy. He wanted that money because he was already taking pieces or bits from the pot already. He could have taken more then. Verse 4, and he went to the leading priests and captains of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus to them. Take for a moment, just a minute here, and I want you to picture somebody in your life, your best friend, someone you absolutely dearly love, that person that comes to your mind right now. And you think about like how good they make you feel, how accountable they help you, how accountable they are to you, and the way that you can just send them a text that nobody else in the world would understand but them. If I have a friend of mine that years ago, we worked together at the airport. And she was my manager. She was the station manager. And this is, I know this is ridiculous. And this isn't theatrics. This is just what we would do. We would speak in whale to each other. Do you know how a whale talks? Right? Finding Dory. Research that movie and you'll learn. I've called her up years later and left a voicemail with just those sounds. I'm not even kidding. It brings me such joy. And then she just knew, it's Gordon. I can't believe it. And we just laughed and we joked. That friend, that person. And then picture you sitting down with some people and plotting how you're going to betray that person. Jesus was close to Judas, obviously not as close as others perhaps, but he walked with Jesus. He heard from Jesus. He watched Jesus. He was there. There was this friendship, this continual, ongoing, at least some level of a bond. And yet he was plotting how to betray Jesus. They were delighted. The religious people were delighted that they were going to take this person down and they promised to give him money. So he agreed and began looking for an opportunity to destroy or to betray Jesus so they could arrest him when the crowds weren't around, right? Because we don't want to do our sin in public, because then people would know the type of people we really are. We want to do it in silence. That's why we never go to a cafe to go to a browser we don't belong on. We stay up till midnight looking at stuff we shouldn't be looking at. That's why we hide conversations and texts from people, because we don't display it on a screen up here. Hey, look at some of the stuff I said this week. We don't do that. We keep it hidden. Or dare I say, we even delete them so that nobody ever knows. Their sin, they were trying to keep inside. They knew what they were doing was wrong, but they loved their status. They loved where they were. They loved who they were and what they got to do. They loved the fact that the poor would have to bow down before them, and they would stand so tall, and they'd throw them a little something. I am so good. And they just loved that feeling of power. Over history, all of life, you can see this play for power. In Europe, we see it right now, a play for power. People just wanting more and more control, which is in fact an illusion. We don't really have control. It's up to God how it's all going to work out. We have choices, but in the end, he gets to decide how it's all going to play out. And so they're spending time together, and then it comes down to this moment. Now, between verse 6, and we're going to jump all the way to verse 47. I'm just going to break it down for us for just a moment here, the verses in between there. This is the time of Passover and the celebration of unleavened bread, as I said. And so they're getting ready to prepare it. And they'd get together and they would eat together and they spend time together and they would talk through. Well, Jesus had a moment where he began to share what was coming. All right, let's do this together. Grab your little communion cup there. Don't open any of it yet. Don't open it just yet. We're going to read the words of Jesus found in Luke. He took some bread in verse 19 and he gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to his disciples. So we take off the first layer here. He says, this is my body, which is given. It's given, it's not taken. It's given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So together we. After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with his blood, with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. And then together we drink. Now, the wording and the terminology can be confusing for us in modern day 2022, right? Because we look at this and we're going, we don't really understand what all this means. To give you a very brief understanding, in the Bible days, they understood this very, very well, because they would have to take their prized lamb, their prized choice, and then they would go sacrifice it at the temple. And that would be a level of atonement for their sins. And so it came a point in time where God said, listen, no more sacrifices from everybody. We're going to do this one last time. And he became the spotless lamb. Jesus. So when Jesus died, all that sacrifice at the temple stopped. And so today, all these years separated, we're going, we don't really know that talk. Well, his blood was a payment for our sin. You get that? All the stuff that we've ever done. Anytime you've lied the little lie or stole that piece of gum from somebody, it is the reality is we are born with this sin nature. And God made a way through the trailblazer Jesus to say, hey, we're going to create a new path to the Father. Follow me. Sound familiar? And you'll see the Father. You know me, you'll know him. And so as they did this, they spent some time together and they ate and they drank and they enjoyed that time. But Jesus says, I am so eager to eat this Passover with you, because I'm not going to eat it again until the kingdom of God is fulfilled. And he goes through the narrative there. And then it's so interesting. He says, okay, guys, let's go. And they're walking into something. In the classroom, in the Sunday school, we look at this as, oh yeah, then Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, right? We've heard that before. We've tried to say it, messed it up. We tried to spell it, messed it up. But is the word, it's a fascinating word, the Garden of Gethsemane. Oh, he went to the garden and he prayed because he loved his father. This is not a cute Sunday school story. This is not even remotely cute. This is intense. And I hope that we can feel this for just a moment, what's going on. So they're on their way, and this is fascinating that they're going to a garden. Because if you think about how the whole Bible kind of fits together and how the Bible supports itself, history and life began in a garden with the first Adam. He's known as the first Adam. And Adam messed up. Sin begins in a garden. The battle for us happens in a garden, this new life where Jesus is there and Jesus wins. Jesus is known as the second Adam. Where Adam, the first Adam, failed, Jesus does not fail. And then, of course, we read that at the end of the scriptures that life will culminate in a garden city type. So when we read in Matthew 26, we read the Garden of Gethsemane. So it's fascinating that we're in a garden again, right? The end, or the beginning, the end. We got something in the middle here. So what's going on in the middle? They're on their way to the Garden of Gethsemane, but you got to understand what the Gethsemane actually means. It's not just the name of a place. It actually indicates what they did in this place. And so they're walking by all of these olive trees, olive groves, olive whatever, place where they have olive, they're growing olives. And right there, Gethsemane means the press and olive. One word, Gethsemane, the English word, brought together with two individual Greek words, it means press and olive. Jesus was sitting next to or leaning on the olive press. Now, what the heck is an olive press? This is the coolest part about it. The olive press is this huge basin with these things, and then would be this huge ball or drum or whatever that they would roll around. They put the olives inside of this. And as they would roll this around, the olives would get crushed and crushed, and out of the pit of the olive comes olive oil. The best thing ever. They could eat with this. They could burn lamps with this. They could trade with this. This was a hot commodity. But the only way to get the prized oil out of the olive was through the crushing. Jesus is now stepping into his final temptation. This final moment, if you will, and there's some crushing going on. How do you know there's crushing? Well, we can look at Isaiah 53, where he predicts that Jesus was pierced for our rebellion and crushed for our sin. This is a portion of that crushing. How do we know this was hard? How do we know he didn't just skip to the cross? Because there's this passage where he prays to his Father, and he says, what he's trying to say is, if there is any other way to save this human project that you started so long ago, if we could do this any other way, I'm interested in that way. Can you please take this cup from me? I mean, did you ever realize that Jesus actually had it out with his Father? Is there anything else we can do? And while he's there, there's this crushing. And there's this ripping of, and the, how do I say the best of, in his humanity, the best of Jesus is being poured out through the crushing. He was in such torment and such anxiety that he was bleeding as he was sweating. He was sweating blood. And he's trying to have this conversation. He goes back to his disciples and they're passed out asleep. And he says, wake up and pray so you don't go into temptation. And he goes back to pray some more. Anything at all. But he does something that just is remarkable. Not my will, but your will be done. And so Jesus is being crushed. And he goes back a final time to his disciples. They're asleep again. Right? I can only imagine that Jesus would go up to him. I would be so frustrated and I would kick them and I would say, wake up and pray. It was the context within the passage indicates that it was a startling thing. It wasn't a, can you wake up please? Right? Like we wake up kids. Well, maybe you do. I wake up my kids louder. And so you say, wake up. Can you wake up? No, it wasn't like that. It was like, get up, come on, pray so you don't fall into temptation. And while Jesus is saying that, we jump into Luke 22:47. But even as Jesus said this, a crowd approached, led by Judas, one of the 12 disciples. Judas walked over to Jesus to greet him with a kiss. Now, you know that friend that we talked about just moments ago where you were like, oh yeah, that person that I really, really like and I spend time with? What is it that you do that you really connect with them on? Maybe it's coffee, maybe it's coloring, maybe it's hangout, maybe it's movies, maybe it's dinner, maybe it's popcorn, whatever the thing is that you show like how much you value. Something silly as a noise over a phone. Imagine using whatever you have used for years to indicate your love for them, and now you use that same thing to betray them. That's what's going on here, because this kiss is an emblem, a symbol, or a sign of friendship. I value you. Could you imagine walking up to somebody you're about to throw in jail over money that has done nothing but pour themselves into you, and you dare go up to them and you put your lips on their cheek and you say, hello. And so Jesus catches this, which of course he knew was coming, but Jesus said, Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss? Would you betray the Son of Man with a phone call? Would you betray the Son of Man? Would you betray a friend the same way we used to connect? And so Jesus is standing there and experiencing this. Now you remember during the time of dinner, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he indicates that Judas is going to be the one that betrays him and hands him over. And he flat out tells Peter, yeah, you're going to deny me three times. And so here we come into a situation where it appears that Peter is jumping into action, right? Yeah, Peter, you're going to deny me. No, I won't. I'm ready to go to jail for you. I'm ready to die for you. Well, they go to arrest Jesus, and who takes his sword but Peter? Oh, they're going to take Jesus. This is my opportunity. Okay, I will go to jail for you. And he was a horrible swordsman. He was aiming for the head. He got the ear. And Jesus' last recorded miracle was healing an enemy because of one of his followers. You better count the cost. Because this following Jesus stuff is for real. If you're not sure, then just pour yourself into the understanding of God. Can you please teach me what this looks like? Because Jesus, as believers, as representatives of Christ, how often, church, do we have to try to heal or help somebody because of one of Jesus's followers? And we have to make up for it. And we're spending all this time dealing with other people's idiocracies. Just do the fruits of the Spirit, man. And then we'll be okay. But here's Jesus. And he says, whoa, 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 we're not going down that road. We're not doing this. So they arrested him and led him to the high priest home. To the high priest's home. And Peter followed at a distance, the guard. Lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it. And Peter joined them. And the servant girl noticed him in the firelight and began staring at him. So you remember that Jesus told Peter, hey, you're going to deny me. And which he said that in the upper room when they were eating. And so now, let's get real. Come on, Peter. You said you're ready to go to jail for me? You said you're ready to die for me? Cool. Here we go. Hey, she was staring at him. Finally said, this man's one of Jesus's followers. But instead of going to jail and being willing to die for Jesus, he denied it. Woman, he said, I don't even know him. Not even, I didn't spend much time with him. We were casual acquaintances. I don't even know who you're talking about, Peter says. The one that just earlier that day said, or the day before, somewhere within a 24-hour period said, I will go to jail with you. I will die with you. No, girl, I don't even know the man. After a while, someone else looked at him and said, "You must be one of them." "No, man. No, I'm not." About an hour later, someone else insisted. Now, they probably were sitting there talking amongst each other. "This must be one of them because he's a Galilean too." Now, how would they know he's a Galilean? From his accent. They probably listened to him and they were like, I mean, you know, somebody comes from the South. I'd sit there and talk to them all day. Right? You just know. Like, you just, are you from... And you talk to him. So they know right away, oh, this person is a Galilean. But Peter said, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." And immediately what happened, what Jesus said was going to happen, happened. While he was still speaking, while the denial was still fresh, coming out of his mouth and coming out of his being, the rooster crowed. Fascinating, isn't it? All four Gospels record this event. This was a big deal. And at that moment, the Lord turned and looked at Peter. So you have your best friend. You've just used the thing that you connected on to betray them, Judas. You said, "I'm with you to the end. We will go to battle with each other." And then it comes to where you're both supposed to stand on the battle line and you bail. And you claim, I don't know that person. And then you catch that person's eye. You see them. They see you. And at that moment, this flood of comes over you. And the Lord's words flash through Peter's mind. "Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny three times that you even know me." And Peter left the courtyard weeping bitterly. That word bitterly is not just a This is a violent, super ugly, loud cry. This was so intense that you could imagine having such grief that you could probably barely stand. You don't care if anybody sees you, it's that intense of a grief. You're probably spewing snot and tears out as you're running because it's violent. And you feel to the core of who you are, what did I just do? I would imagine, I can only imagine crying that violently that he was probably running away, fell down, got back up and just couldn't keep himself together. Maybe he ran into something because he's just so focused on his grief as he's running off. We don't know if that's true, but I've seen this intense cry and I can only imagine he didn't just casually drift off. He tried to get out of there as fast as he could, violently, probably pushing people out of his way, knocking over tables, just couldn't bear what he had just done. Now we know Jesus is God, and Jesus is also human, complete with all the emotion we humans know well. I can't imagine the painful experience he had after just before Peter. Now he knew he was going to be betrayed. And he was betrayed. And he knew Peter was going to do it. And it still happened. So you know, though, that it had to cut him. Nothing cuts deeper than like a brother's wound, right? It's one thing if somebody passing me down the road gets mad at me. I can forget about you. But it's different than if I go home and I get cut by somebody in my home, right? Because we have that connection. And this is the brotherly connection that they had. Put yourself in Judas's or Peter's sandals for a moment, just for a moment. Can you imagine the weight of such a huge failure resting on your shoulders? If you're them, you realize that you betrayed your friend, someone who had never been anything but kind and loving toward you. You betrayed your friend so badly that they ended up getting not only in trouble, but they got killed for your deception. It's easy for us to point fingers at Judas and Peter, isn't it? Oh, I would never do that. Oh, I would never do that. That moment that we felt uncomfortable when somebody says, "Well, why do you believe?" And then we go, "Well, I'll put you in touch with my pastor." We feel uncomfortable. You know what? You need to stumble through that conversation. You need to fall flat on your face in that conversation. You need to say all the wrong stuff. I give you permission to say all the wrong stuff in that conversation, because you need to understand that you have a voice to share with people. And when we deny him by not saying anything, well, I didn't do it. Well, that's the problem. We didn't do it. We didn't acknowledge it. We didn't say it. We didn't step forward. We didn't acknowledge the injustice. We are denying him all over again. The only benefit from us doing it versus them doing it, Peter had to stare in his eyes. But maybe it's not so different if we are the hands and the feet of Jesus and you are a representative of Christ and you stare at your brother and sister in the face. Then we start feeling like we're being judged, right? You're judging me. No, I'm revealing what you're doing. If you're feeling a level of judgment, it's not mine. Maybe there's a conviction going on there you need to deal with. So what is it? What is it that you're dealing with right now? Maybe you betrayed a friend, someone who had never been anything but nice to you. Maybe, just maybe, you're on an internet explorer, an internet browser that you shouldn't be on. Maybe, just maybe, the secret that's holding you back is that you paid for that abortion. Maybe, just maybe, there's something going on that you just couldn't imagine acknowledging. You know, Jesus doesn't give up on you. Don't waste your one life trying to hold on to something that Jesus can forgive, no matter what it is. So let's look and see how Jesus handled this. If you want to know how Jesus is going to handle you through your stuff, let's look at this for a moment. So Jesus, we're going to jump over the crucifixion. We're going to jump into the resurrection. And we're looking at a time where Jesus, in the book of John, chapter 21, is with his disciples, and he has made them breakfast. He is hosting the ones that walked away. He is hosting one of two that denied and betrayed him. See, one of the greatest tragedies that I read in this passage is that Peter is going to experience a level of restoration, and Judas never gave him the chance. The prophecy was fulfilled when Judas betrayed Jesus. There was no prophecy that that betrayer had to die. What a tragedy to not even be able to connect with Jesus again. So let's look and see how this worked out for Peter. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," Peter replied. "You know I love you." "Then feed my lambs." Jesus repeated the question again. "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," Peter said. You know I love you." "Then take care of my sheep." A third time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." This is far more profound than what I just read. Jesus asked him a question. There's two different forms of love that we're looking at here from the Greek understanding. We have the agape love, which is this divine, sacrificial, complete love. And then we have another Greek word pronounced phileo, which is more brotherly love, friendship love. And Jesus says, "Do you agape me? Do you divinely, do you completely, sacrificially love me?" And Peter goes, "You know I phileo you. You know I love you like a brother." Jesus says, "Now, do you really sacrificially love me?" And Peter goes, "Yes, I phileo you. I love you like a brother." So then Jesus looks at this, just the only way Jesus looks at things, right? "I'm gonna meet you where you are. Peter, do you phileo me? Yes, Peter says, I phileo, I love you like a brother. And he says, well then feed, take care of, pasture my people. And so three times, Peter publicly denied Jesus. Jesus gave Peter an opportunity three times to publicly declare his love for his Savior. This restoration has occurred. What a beautiful connection in this moment for them to connect in a way that says, I forgive you, I am with you, I am for you. And for Peter to have moments of, I am so sorry, and trying to restore this relationship. Unfortunately, Judas never had that opportunity. Jesus never gives up on us. Now let's take a moment here together and let's just have a moment in prayer. I want to invite you to bow your head, close your eyes. I'm not going to ask anybody to raise hands or step, stand up or come forward, nothing like that. This is so intense. You just need to have a moment with the Lord. And so the way this would go is that I just invite you in your heart, in your mind, not out loud, to simply ask God, is there anything that I have done that needs revealed? Any hidden sin? Now, if there is one, it's very possible you already are aware of it. We need to have a moment of just asking for forgiveness. God, I am sorry. I ask you to forgive me of my sin of neglect, abuse, fear, letting fear control me, letting worry control me, being just downright mean to people, not showing the fruits of the Spirit. What is it? A secret relationship that nobody else knows, that if anybody else knew, it would destroy everything. At least that's what you think. I want you to have a moment for the next minute. I just want you to pray to God and listen. And when you're done, just look back up here for a moment. We've all been there. We all need a forgiveness for something, all of us. And so you're in good company. You're in good company that there's individuals sitting around you that if you knew their story, you'd probably wonder the same thing about whatever you think people are going to worry about you. You know, David had a thought. King David had a thought about this, and he wrote in Psalm 32. Natalie read it for us at the beginning of here. This is his repentance psalm. If you have a moment of repentance, you need to read Psalm 32 and see how David processed this. In verse 1, oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away and I groaned all day long. Sin will kill you from the inside out. And by the time you see it, it's too late because it's just ravaged you on the inside. Forgiveness, you're not beyond forgiveness. But man, oh man, the stuff that you would have had to deal with and experience, what torture. Day and night, your hand of discipline was on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. Therefore, let all the godly pray to you while there is still time, that they may not drown in the floodwaters of judgment. for you are my hiding place. You protect me from trouble. You surround me with songs of victory. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway of your life, down to the right trail, as I blaze a new one for you. I will advise you and watch over you. Do not be like a senseless horse or mule that needs a bit or a bridle. Now, if you grew up in a church that used the King James only Bible, you know they didn't use mule in the Bible. They used a flavorful three-letter word. And we're being told, don't be that. Many sorrows come to the wicked, but unfailing love surrounds those who trust the Lord. So rejoice in the Lord and be glad, all who obey him. Shout for, say this word, joy. Shout for joy, all those whose hearts are pure. How can you have that joy? It's those whose obedience is forgiven, whose sin is out of sight, whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. David says, this is the only way to live. I have lived the other way, and it's no good. This is the way to go. He knew something that we need to know and hold on to, our big idea, Jesus never gives up on us, never. He's not giving up on you. He's not done with you. Somebody has a problem with you. You know what? Apologize if you did something wrong and just follow up with, be patient with me. The Lord's not done with me yet. So how do we make this whole thing practical? How do we make this whole narrative like something that we can do something with? Well, here's our next steps. Is there anything you need to make right with God right now? That's what we were doing just moments ago, where you have a moment of prayer, where you have a moment together. Now listen, if it's true that Jesus never gives up on you, what's one thing that you can do this week to respond to that truth? I would have anticipated the first week of the series to be a little bit more lighthearted, more jokes, less, this is God's word and it's been shared to us. What are you gonna do about it? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus and we thank you for your word. Thank you for it being a guiding light, a light to our path. Thank you for that light, your word, being a light to the trail that you've already blazed for us. I pray that we will likewise be these trailblazers, that we will follow in your footsteps to make it easier for others as well, that we would come along one another and that we would encourage one another and be a blessing to one another. In Jesus' name, we all say, amen. All right, hey, real quick here, just for a moment, just 1-2 minutes. This little packet that you received on your way in is for everybody, whether you would consider CLC your church family or whether or not you're visiting. This is for everybody. If you consider yourself a follower of Jesus, this is for you. And here's why. The board of directors oversees, along with the staff, Community Life Church. And in the board of directors, there is a nominating committee. And that nominating committee has put together 3 fine people to be nominated to the board of directors. Now, we are looking for everybody that is a follower of Jesus to pray over these individuals. We have a little bio there that they wrote. We have a picture in there of their face that they took. And so you can actually go around and you can see for yourself, like, who's here. Now, Kristen is here today. There's Kristen right over here in the back middle here. And so you can just go around and hold this up to people's face and see if it's for real. That'd be kind of fun and weird. So I want you to look over this and pray over that. Then, and we're gonna do that for 2 weeks. Got it? We're gonna pray over these individuals for 2 weeks. Then on Palm Sunday, we are going to have for one day, we're gonna have an online voting. And if you don't have access to online, those people watching, I know you do, you have access to online. And so we're gonna have a computer in the lobby for you to be able to go. Now, what the board of directors is looking for is these 3 individuals to be affirmed. We're actually looking for all 3 of these to be on the board of directors. If in your prayer time or in your discussion with the individual, you say, you know what? There's a specific reason I'm not comfortable affirming this person, then just simply leave it blank. So that way, we as official CLC family members will then affirm in 2 weeks these individuals. So take this with you. This is yours. Pray over them. Ask God to show you anything, and even take a moment to reach out to any one of these. Two of them, John and Jimmy, were here first service. So you may have to jump service a week or two just to get to know some new people. How cool is that? That'd be super great. All right. Any questions? Please don't hesitate to call the church office. Reach out to me, and we'll talk about it. All right. Will you stand? Receive the blessing of the Lord. If you're heading over to the restaurant, they're ready for you. I'm going to be heading over here shortly to wash dishes. We're raising money for real. I'm for real washing dishes, and then I'm going to eat. And so we're going doing that as a fundraiser for camp, sending our students to camp. And Las Peñas is open today. They're not usually open on Sundays, but they're open today because we have built such a great relationship with them. We love them, and they love us, and we take care of each other. So make sure you check that out. Now, receive the blessing of the Lord as we head out here today. I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your heart as you trust in him. Now say it with me. Go and be the church.